Hello, welcome to another edition of the Mike Zielinski Show. I'm Mike Zielinski. I'm honored today to have as my guest John Graydon Smith, who is the director of the Reading Public Museum. Welcome, John.
Thanks for having me.
Exciting times at the Reading Public Museum. It's certainly not the museum our grandfathers or even my generation knew. It's not just old paintings and a mummy. It has become a really broad-based institution with a lot more educational opportunities for school kids, younger kids. You have all great exhibits for kids, plus your traditional ones, and we'll get to that. I think it's interesting, the attendance is up again at the museum this year, and apparently it has been for the last 7 years, which, not by dumb luck, but I think by your presence, because you've been there 7 years, because it's a little different model at the museum. You're not a curator. The museum already had some really outstanding, I guess, curators in place, or you brought them in, but you're a business guy. You're a CPA
and MBA.
MBA.
Yep.
So you were here to reinforce the short-term viability and build the long-term viability. So tell us a little bit about why the board chose someone with your skill set.
Yeah, well, I think it was breaking the mold for the mm-hmm. board at the Reading Public Museum, but it was the right choice, I think. And you're seeing it really across the, not just museum, but really the nonprofit industry as a whole. People looking outside of, you know, program development people or in the museum world, curators, to business folks to run their operation because, we always say not-for-profit is a tax status, not a business plan. And that's
well put.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's really how we look at it. For us, it's a matter of, obviously providing the mission-driven value that the organization was created to provide to the community. But it's got to be done effectively, and it's got to run like a business, because otherwise, you know, the other saying is no money, no mission, and that's really, you know, kind of what we've been tasked with bringing around in at the museum. And so, after a couple of decades of having curators run the shop with mixed success, they looked to me to try and sort of break that mold and focus on running more effectively as a business, which then, when that happens, in turn, you can provide more product and service to the community you serve.
It all comes down to the bottom line, but as you grow your budget, it affords you the opportunity for more educational opportunities, which kind of fulfills, you referenced mission a couple times, but the original mission, I guess, of the museum was to really be educationally interactive.
Oh, yeah.
And it was very affiliated or was run by the Reading School District back
for
in
years.
The day.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you're kind of getting back to that to a degree, right?
Yeah, I mean, I have a picture of Levi Mengel in my office. He was the founder of the museum. And
isn't there a moving...
There is. There's an animatronic Dr. Mengel. Yeah,
yeah, I was going to say robot,
office.
But yeah, I guess right. That was pre-robot.
Yeah, yeah. And he greets visitors to the museum. But his vision for the institution was to have a hands-on, interactive environment for kids to learn about. He felt that touching and doing was more effective than reading and looking. And that's something that now, 100 years later, is pretty widespread throughout the museum and science center industry.
Yeah.
But it was revolutionary for its time. And so all we've done, since I've been here, is really just try and get back to that original mission, give kids something to do and interact and engage with. And we know now that that's an effective way for them to learn.
Well, I was exposed to it several times, and which is why I wanted to have you as a guest. We took our grandchildren over to see some of the exhibits, the Lego toys, the Hot Wheel cars, the dinosaurs, and they were wonderful. The kids were thrilled and had so much fun. We'll have to get over to see the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Secrets of the Sewer.
Yep, that's the current one.
Yeah, and I'm not sure what the secrets of the sewer are, but I guess we'll find out.
Yeah, well, that's where the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles live, and so it's
okay.
Just like a lot of those exhibits that you mentioned, the idea to get kids really engaged is to have an immersive experience. So kids anymore, it's different from when we were growing up. They're, now everybody has a massive, high-definition television in their house, and people have...
I didn't even have color set when I was a kid.
Right, exactly.
You know? And
yeah.
there was like three channels.
Yeah, exactly. I remember getting up and turning the thing. Yeah. You know, it's...
Oh, yeah, there were no remotes.
No, exactly. Yeah. And you know, now kids have virtual reality and
they're on their cell phones.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. So, you know, for us to be able to engage those kids and keep them interested, you've got to be immersive. You've got to have hands-on experiences that are technology-driven. And so Secrets of the Sewer just really takes you into the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle world and lets you explore like you're one of the turtles. So.
Oh, that's awesome. I've got to be over there. Repeat customers are kind of like your bread and butter. So when you have exhibits like this, the kids are coming back, their parents and grandparents are coming with them, and is it a residual effect that the parents and grandparents actually will come sometimes without the kids just to look at the other exhibits?
Yeah, I mean, so we've seen a couple of things happen. We've seen, so first off, kids don't drive themselves, and, you know, so that's, so you do stuff for kids, they want to go, but you got to bring, you know, parents along. But these shows are also designed in such a way to keep adults engaged so that they can learn right alongside the kids or the grandkids, you know, whoever they're bringing along. We've seen then that those family units will go to other parts of the museum and explore the permanent collections, arms and armor, the fine art galleries, the North American Indian Gallery.
Armor,
absolutely.
Yeah.
There's great stuff. And so they might be coming in for the headline show, but then they're also exploring the rest of the museum. And then, yes, we do see where adults are saying, hey, I want to spend more time, you know, doing XYZ, but maybe it's not as conducive to have, you know, little ones around when I do that. So then they're coming back. And in addition to our attendance continuing to grow and really skyrocket over the last several years, membership has done the same thing because people see, you know, that now you're not just coming to the museum once a year or once every couple of years. You're coming to the museum 3, 4, 5 times a year, and sometimes you're coming to the same show multiple times. So buying that membership really pays off for your family, and it's an investment in the institution, helps us, and it helps the family save money.
You know, it's interesting because, and I know we talked about this before we came on the program, and it's kind of like apples and oranges stats, but forgive me, and that's a little dated, it was like 2011, but the American Alliance of Museums had a study, and according to this, there were 850 million visitors that year who went to museums, which exceeded all major league sporting events and theme parks combined, which did 483 million. Now, for some reasons, that's not a direct match, but still, that's one eye-popping stat.
Yeah, I mean, people like museums, and you know, I can't speak necessarily to every museum, although I do get some exposure to a lot of institutions in the various roles that I have in our industry, but certainly here in Reading, you know, our reported attendance in 2010, which is the year that I arrived here, was about 30,000 people, and I think that was probably generous. This year, we're definitely going to see more than 125,000 visitors. And so, you know, you have that kind of growth.
That's like Reading Fight and Phil's attendance.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean,
for the season.
You know, and the Phil's, you know, they do, we're in the same business that they're in.
You know, you're kind of like with the younger kids, your educational and entertainment business.
Yep.
You know, and Scott Hunziker, the GM there for a long time before that Chuck Domino, they've been in the entertainment business for a long time.
Absolutely, yeah. And they do a great job of it. They're a partner of ours. Matter of fact, we just had our Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle Takeover Day a couple of weeks ago, and the R. Phil's Kids Club members got to come in at a discounted rate. You know, so we try and partner with them because we're in the same business, and it's the same audience. You know, we're trying to entertain, and I say that all the time. We compete with shopping malls and movie theaters and mini golf courses. That's who
There's
our
a lot of competition
are.
Out there.
Yeah, you know, we're trying to attract families who are looking for something to do with their discretionary dollars, and the nice thing about our place is you can have a good time, but you also get some enrichment out of it, you know, hopefully with some learning experiences as well.
Speaking of the learning experience, besides the young kids or relatively young children coming to the exhibits, what other educational opportunities do you do with school districts?
Well, we have attendance from really every school district in Berks, and then even beyond. We have Harrisburg City Schools this year that we're coming, Downingtown.
So you're really a regional museum.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. We draw, especially in schools, because we provide an experience that's really unique. And even if you think about, the districts down towards Philadelphia, it's a lot cheaper and easier to get to us than it is to get down to maybe say the Franklin Institute.
And free parking.
Right, exactly. And we have free parking. So, so we draw from a very wide swath. And so in addition to the field trips and the planetarium experiences that we offer to schools, we do educational summer camps, which just started up this week.
Camps are big business, whether it's sports or cultural.
Absolutely. Yeah. And ours are great because they're what we call STEAM camps. So science, technology, engineering, art, and math. And we cover those in every week. So kids have a great time doing that. We have our Uncorked Creativity, which is an opportunity for people of all ages to come in, well, 21 and up because we allow booze, but to come in and paint, learn from one of our instructors, and we do that once a month where they can come in and they do their own painting. They leave with their own piece of artwork. So we're doing all kinds of stuff. If you drive by the museum pretty much any time between 7 a.m. and really, 7, 8 p.m. at night, every day of the week, you're going to see a full parking lot because there's always something going on there.
From the exhibits for adults, what were some of the highlights you've had in the last few years?
Well, it's interesting because people do talk a lot about the kids shows.
But there's so much more there. Yeah,
absolutely. We continue to do a lot of things. So, for example, this fall we have an exhibition of called Hands on Harley, which is Harley Davidson scaled for kids. And there's a kids kids-sized shop that they can go in. They learn all the science about how motorcycles work and riding motorcycles. And in the next gallery over, we'll have a collection of privately owned Harley Davidson motorcycles that you won't be able to see. We've sourced them out, partnering with Classic Harley Davidson and Tompkins Vist Bank. We've sourced out this collection of motorcycles from different private collectors in the area, including the Captain America bike that was featured in Easy Rider that was ridden by Peter Fonda.
That's an iconic bike.
This show is going to be amazing. So, great stuff for kids, also great stuff
for
adults.
When's that coming up?
That opens this fall, September 22nd. Okay. Both of those shows open. And at the same time, we'll have an exhibition called Pop Art, which are selections from the Weissman Foundation Collection, which is a California-based collection privately held of pop art. So names like Andy Warhol, Roy Lichtenstein, some of those.
My generation, yeah.
Yeah.
Is Peter Max one of those guys?
I think there is a Peter Max in that show.
Yeah.
And there's just great, so we've got the art, we've got stuff for kids, we've got bikes, which are art as well, but really appeal to a vast audience out there. So there's still a lot of adult activity that's going on at the museum as well. So
what kind of cool kid exhibits do you have coming up? Because I know you said you're working on 2020 already.
Yeah, I'm booking 2020 right now.
Wow. But we even how about 18 and 19 too?
Actually 2018. Yeah,
if you can remember it all.
Right. Yeah. Well, I brought my list, we're about to announce. Matter of fact, I'll announce it on the world premiere on your show.
We
just inked a deal with Wells Fargo, who is going to serve as one of the sponsors. We're still looking for another sponsor. So if you're out there watching and you want to sponsor, Doc McStuffins, which is a Disney Junior program.
Well, hey, I'm a grandfather. I'm familiar with it. Yeah.
So
for the youngest kids.
It's for preschool kids, and then even my 8-year old grew up with Doc McStuffins too. But it's the first time ever that Disney is doing a museum exhibition. And
they're doing it in Reading.
It's going to 8 places in the entire world. We're one of them.
How did you land that? Just because of the other things that you've done? Resume?
Yeah, we've worked with, it's being marketed through the Children's Museum of Indianapolis, and we've worked with them heavily. Legos came from them. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles has come from them. Okay. Hot Wheels came from them. And so we have a great relationship with them. We've worked very hard at it for several years. It's been in the pipeline. And that's going to open in January of 2018, as will a show called Ice Age, after the dinosaurs, Ice Age, Land of Mammals and Ice. And so that's, think of the animatronic dinosaur show that we did a couple of years ago. This is the woolly mammoth and the saber-toothed tiger and all of those kind of
animals.
That's
going to really be.
Oh, it's going to be, yeah, it's going to be fabulous. So that those shows both open. Doc opens in January. Ice Age opens in February. Next summer, we have a show of Kinects, the toys that are made in Pennsylvania.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And they've created an entire exhibition of theme park, amusement park rides that you can interact with. And so they're massive roller coasters and Ferris wheels. You push buttons, you make them go, you do all kinds of stuff. And then there are build stations teaching kids about engineering and building and creating. That's our big summer show next year. So we've got a great lineup. You know, we're really in the sweet spot right now of hit after hit after hit. So we're pretty excited.
What about exhibits for adults coming up?
Yeah, absolutely. So next January, also January of 18, we are opening an exhibition of Keith Haring's work, celebrating the anniversary of his first show. And of course, Keith was born at the Reading Hospital, right across the street from the museum.
Yeah,
and was from Kutztown. And so we're doing a show of his work. We have a political
that
posters.
That will be very, very well received.
Absolutely. Yeah, his work is very popular around here. We have a political posters show next fall that'll coincide with the election cycle. And then we're opening a huge show of, it's called Across the Atlantic, American Impressionism Through the French Lens. And it's all works from our collection. It's French Impressionism as well as American Impressionism.
Yeah, I'm not that I'm an art person, but you always hear about French Impressionism.
Yeah.
But not so much American, right?
Yeah, so American Impressionism isn't as quote-unquote popular with some of the big names, but the work is amazing.
And you'll create some awareness of it by having this.
Absolutely, yeah. The show opens in Reading in September and then is going to travel. Matter of fact, we've only got one slot left on the tour. It's going to tour for about 4 years, and we've sold that to a variety of museums around the country that are taking that show after it closes here. And one exciting thing that we're working on is bringing in a couple of loans. We own some good French Impressionism, but we're working on bringing in some loans. The ink isn't dry on the deal yet, so I don't want to spoil exactly where, but we're looking at bringing in one of the biggest names in French Impressionism and who's never been displayed in Reading before. So,
you know, and people probably don't realize it, and I just have a very superficial knowledge of it, but you just don't ship the paintings or whatever. I mean, there is a lot involved.
Yeah.
I mean, temperature control and, I mean,
yeah.
Are you the point person in all this? I know you have a staff helping you. But
yeah, Scott Schweigert, our chief curator, is really the one who handles it. And he and his staff, Ashley Hamilton, who's our registrar and collections manager, they handle a lot of the logistics. Now, when we ship...
Logistics, yeah, there's a lot of
A lot that goes with it. When a painting like that, or like when our Degas paintings, we have three Degas in the collection, when they travel... someone goes with them. When it went to Australia, I went with it.
That's not a bad deal.
No, that's being the director.
The perk of being a boss.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
But so, you know, one of us always travels with the painting to watch it come out of the crate, make sure it, you know, when you're dealing with works that are that valuable, you know, it's important.
Yeah, a lot of pressure too.
And, it's the good side of it. But so people don't necessarily realize, and I didn't really realize, you know, that's how it worked. But we have, at any given time, we'll have probably 200 to 300 pieces on loan to other institutions around the world from Reading. And so, you know, that's a big business for us as well. We put together exhibitions and then lease them out to other museums across the globe. And it's a great source of income for us, too.
Anything else on the horizon? Because that already is a heck of a lineup.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot going on there. You know, in addition to the big exhibitions, then we're always filling smaller spaces. And then one thing that has changed over the last, you know, half a decade or so is that the permanent exhibition galleries are always changing. And so, for example, the North American Indian Gallery, which is always there and always open, we just installed a fantastic collection from our collection of American Indian headdresses that is just blow your mind.
Oh, really?
They're really spectacular. And so that just went on display about a week or so ago. And then this fall, we're currently in the process of demolition and renovating the science wing, which is on the first floor of the museum, you go up the first set of stairs and all the way to the side, we had rocks and minerals and some taxidermy. We're reinstalling those galleries as sort of a trip around the globe through animal habitats. We're bringing out a new collection of taxidermy that we just acquired, and it'll take kids and their caregivers around the world. You'll pick up your passport and go around to Africa. We'll have elephants and lions and giraffes. And I mean,
that's incredible.
Oh, it's going to be a fabulous new addition, and that's a permanent change to the gallery.
The museum had been stagnant for a number of years, and you've basically changed all that and brought a lot of vibrancy to the organization.
Well, we're trying to. I mean, my attitude is, we're in Reading, Pennsylvania. There aren't tour buses pulling up all the time. There aren't tourists from all over the place that are just, you know, showing up looking for something to do.
Only certain times a year.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So we really have to attract repeat business, like you mentioned earlier, and you don't do that by having the same stuff on the walls all the time.
Yeah.
And so, that's one reason membership has gone up, and we also can draw from, you know, outside of Berks County a lot more effectively than we used to be able to, and it's, you know, it's been working for us.
I know you've run several businesses, including your own. You've been involved in the nonprofit world, including another museum. Mm-hmm. But is this the most fun job you've ever had?
Yeah, it's got its moments. It's like anything else. It's a job, and if I hit the Powerball tonight, I'm not sure that I'm coming back tomorrow.
Oh, really? But, you have such a passion for it.
I'm kidding. But, it is. It's a lot of fun. There's just a lot of opportunity with how broad the mission is at the museum. It gives us the leeway to do a lot of different things and still be mission-driven. So it's exciting, and it's also, you know, I was the CEO at the American Lung Association, for example, and, we did great work, and it was very fulfilling, but, you know, the CEO's job a lot of the time is dealing with lawyers and accountants and doing the back-end stuff. And here at the museum, when I get tired of doing that, I can just walk down the hall and see all the people pouring through the doors to do what it is that we're in business to do, and that recharges the batteries.
What's your biggest challenge now? Because you've had such great success. How do you sustain it and grow it? I know you want to continue growing the budget. How was that done?
Well, it's difficult. The property that we're located on is very difficult. We're landlocked. We're in kind of a tough spot, and the school district still owns the buildings and the grounds, which creates some logistical challenges for us. So that's really something that we need to be taking a look at and trying to sort that through. Adding new wings to the building isn't something I'm interested in. We're a good size in terms of square footage, but it's really a matter of trying to drive community engagement in unique ways. For example, just last week we had a sold out show in the planetarium, in the NEAG planetarium, of fireworks that were sensory friendly. So autistic children, people who struggle with the loud bangs that normally
along
with fireworks.
Technology is amazing.
We had fireworks in the planetarium and along with patriotic music, and we sold that out, and we've never done something like that before. We're doing a lot more now, sensory friendly kind of things.
The planetarium just by itself is a wonderful place.
Absolutely.
And people sometimes, I hope they don't forget about it, because it's not just a museum, it's the planetarium.
Absolutely, yeah. The grounds, the arboretum. You know, it's 25 acres of beautiful
the grounds
gardens
are great.
And, outdoor sculpture that we're adding
but
to
But you can't
all the time.
Feed the ducks anymore. I mean, one of the charms was take your little kids. We did, I guess it was a different world then.
Yeah.
Feed them bread, but that wasn't good for
it's
them.
It's not good for the ducks. we do that for the ducks' protection and for yours. The ducks are still there to look at, and the grounds are great.
I've been there sometimes, and I've seen people, they kind of like just bring a picnic lunch.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
And we sell, sandwiches inside that people can get and take outside. Yeah.
You know, and it's kind of nice, especially if you work in the West Reading, Lansing area, a beautiful day, that's a great place to have lunch.
Absolutely. Matter of fact, I saw some people today who I know who just said hi as I was walking in the door, and that's exactly what they did. They brought their picnic lunch, they sat at one of our tables, we have free Wi-Fi sort of around the building, and they were able to hang out.
So and the museum, I know maybe you still do weddings and different events for organizations.
Yeah, we're heavily rented all the time.
Well, it's gorgeous, especially that when you first walk in, it's breathtaking.
Yeah, so that we do a lot of weddings. We'll probably do 75 weddings a year, different events, proms, fundraisers for other organizations.
Got a lot of moving parts over there.
There are, but that's, you know, that's my job. We have experts in all kinds of areas, and then I'm just the guy
have to
who
put
sits
it all
there.
Together,
and, well, I get to do very little, but it looks like I'm doing a lot. So
And so have you learned a lot about paintings, too? Or I know you're not a curator. But
yeah, you know I have. And it's funny because I'll go places now, and I can kind of, you know, talk my way through it a lot of times when I'm doing things. I don't purport to be an expert, but I do. Scott Schweigert, our curator, is a genius, and he's taught me a lot. And so that's been one of the fun things too, is expanding my horizons.
So you're I think you said earlier that it's more and more common now for museums executive directors to be business people, not necessarily curators. So you're not exception in the industry.
Well, I'm still probably an exception, but that's changing.
Yeah.
You know, the numbers, when I took over at the American Lung Association, I was one of the very few in the industry who wasn't a program person, who didn't come up through the program side. And that was especially true in the museum world. You know, you did a lot of curators and that sort of thing. Now it is changing, and I get a lot more phone calls now from people saying, you're the kind of person we want to run our place, more so than an expert in fine art, and the very successful institutions have figured that out.
You have to have a lot of satisfaction. I know you're never satisfied, but what you've already accomplished.
I don't get to do it very often, but it is nice when people say, you know, hey, matter of fact, I love hearing people say, you know, my kids are growing up with a completely different museum than I did. And
there's no question about that.
That excites me. That's fantastic, because I don't necessarily see it because I'm in the fishbowl a lot of the time. But, there are people and they're, you know, I have funders who are 85 years old who grew up with that museum. And I had one in particular who came into a gallery and said, you know, this gallery hasn't changed in my entire life, and you finally made it happen. And you know, things like that, they're very gratifying for me.
Well, I personally believe that the Reading Public Museum is a showcase. It's a treasure for us to have in our community, and we're blessed to have it. And for any of my viewers out there who haven't been there recently, you know what you're missing. So please get out there. Thank you, John Graydon Smith, director of the Reading Public Museum. And we appreciate you taking the time, and best of luck. And I'll have to get my grandkids out there soon. And there's a lot of exciting things coming in the next few years. And thanks, everyone, for your support of BCTV and for watching all our programming. And don't forget to watch The Mike Zielinski Show. And for now, this is take care and enjoy your summer.